Good evening, everybody, or I'm saying good evening because, well, I'm in good old Europe and it's kind of like 9 p.m., but I hope I'm still like energetic enough for you. So let's dive into this observability topic, what it is not, what you can make out of that. Since we've already covered my intro where I work, let's skip that and let's go right for the content. So normally, if this was an in-person event, I would ask the audience and then wait for you to raise your hand, who is using what or who is doing this kind of thing. We'll just do that mentally. So I'm assuming if I would ask you who is using logs, that a lot of you would raise their hand because it's probably the most common tool to get to know what is up in your production application. Just thinking about logs in general, it is something that you need to explicitly do in your application. So if you don't have like the right log statement, nothing is happening. And it is very much on the component level. So it's not like the full request scope where you're at, but it's really like at this point in the code, something, once you run through that, you're just outputting whatever that log statement is doing, which was a very helpful tool for a long time and still is, just to show you what is going on, to give you a hint what your application is up to. But it is not the only thing. It is still the most widely used one because it's very easy to get started with and very easy to understand. And you can then try to breach out from that. So for example, if you have an application and you want to correlate all the calls or everything that happens from one request from a user, you might add a correlation ID to your logs. So you might add something like, there are various libraries which you can add that there is a unique ID within one request that you could then figure out, like, these are all the logs belonging to one request from a user. So you could kind of see the full story and then you would try to break out of that component level. But in general, logs are very much about, like, at this point in the code, something happened. By the way, just as a side note, oftentimes you want to make something out of your log. So if you have like a classic log line with a timestamp and a log level and some message, you don't want to really write that out as one string, but you want to have more of a structured message. So what you would often want to have is like, you would say like, give me all the errors in the previous hour. And then it would make a lot of sense to have that data a bit more structured than just these individual lines. If you don't want to write regular expressions, probably structure that in your application logs right away. It will make your life a lot easier. Unless you really want to write regular expressions, which I always call the Stockholm syndrome, because you get so used to writing those regular expressions that at some point you start liking it. Or maybe it's job security, because while you can write regular expressions, it's very hard for anybody else to read them and figure out what you were trying to do. So that's kind of the log part. It's probably the most widely used approach to getting any insights into your production application, but it is a bit limited because it's very much on that component level and it requires that manual work to, well, write the log statement. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. Next thing that is probably very widely used are metrics, maybe with Prometheus or whatever else you're using to collect metrics. It is generally a periodic measurement of whatever value that you have. And the very nice thing about that is that you can aggregate those, which makes storing them pretty cheap if you aggregate them and just store the aggregation. Or it's also very nice to see an overview of, if you aggregate all the requests of your users in the past hour, you could get the average of the response times. Though averages could be very treacherous because while many users might have quick response times and might be happy, there might be some outliers, so the average might hide something and you might want to switch to percentiles, for example. So metrics are a very nice tool to actually see like how is kind of probably the usage experience or how is some measurement working for all of my users or a subset of my users that you can see how stuff is working out for them. And the third and probably least common approach here is APM for application performance monitoring or tracing. Especially distributed tracing is very popular nowadays. If you have anything that resembles a microservice with logs, it's kind of hard unless you have these correlation IDs to see what is really happening throughout your entire system. And tracing is trying to fill that gap. So tracing is switching from that component level, like you're in that microservice, it is switching to the application level. So it has more the view of, this is a user, the user is doing a request, and then you want to see the entire scope on the application level as a whole for that specific user. So to see this was the request and it touched these services and it took in total that amount of time and there was a response code and that was the response code that you wanted, etc. So the nice thing about this is that it has a more holistic view from a user perspective because it really has this application level. The downside is that it is creating a lot of data oftentimes, and it is kind of a newer tool, and there is a bit more magic involved basically, because normally you would have some instrumentation that you need to add to your application. Though it is oftentimes pretty easy to get started with, and distributed tracing is becoming more and more popular for that. So it is one of the three tools that are probably making sense. So what is observability? So we have covered three things that are useful, and now we just combine them to make a full system out of that. Well, we'll see in a moment. Probably you have seen this visualization, or maybe you have not. These are the three pillars, or oftentimes in practice, it's like the three tools, and then people equate that to observability. So it is logging and tracing and metrics that we have already covered. There's also an overlap between them. So for example, if you have your logs and you have some tracing, you could have request scoped events. So that was when I said like you could have that request ID, that request comes in and every log statement from that request gets a unique ID. And then you could see all the logs for that specific call from a user. And then you would have a request scoped event where you could see like, these are all the log entries for this specific user request. Same goes for metrics. You could also have something where you aggregate or where you try to build metrics out of your logs and have them aggregatable or build so-called rollups where you aggregate them together. And then the real goal, depending on where you see observability, would be to combine all of those when you have something that is request scoped. So it has not just a component view, but this whole application lifecycle view. And you have aggregatable events, so you get a better overview. And then what people often said is, okay, I have these three tools, I throw them together, and in the end, this is what is observability. Well, not so fast. I really like this quote that is, I think, very true, is that, well, gasoline, motor oil, and tires are like the three pillars of Formula One racing, which is not totally wrong. And saying logs, metrics, and traces are the pillars of observability is also not wrong, but it's kind of not the essence of what you're trying to capture. Because observability is trying to capture a bit more of a broader scope. And obviously, we have seen this before. Any vendor having a tool in one of these areas will try to fill the other two, and then you throw everything together and suddenly you magically get to observability, right? And where we have probably seen that before is in DevOps. So I don't even want to bash on any of these tools because these are all good and widely used tools and they are essential for having DevOps, but they are not the essence of DevOps. So the idea is not that you that you throw together all of these tools and the result will automatically be DevOps. Since we're at a DevOps event, I assume most of you will agree with that. Otherwise, we can have a discussion about that. But it's not so much about like using all these tools and that will equate DevOps, but DevOps has a bigger thought or concept behind it. Pets versus kettle also plays into that, and I'm sure many of you have heard that the pets was, I remember when I got my first virtual server on the internet, it was my pet. It had a name. I raised it by hand. I kind of like took care of it. Also, if it ever broke, I would never be able to recreate it because it had grown over the years and I had just created everything by hand, which leads us to the modern approach where kettle is the infrastructure approach that you want to automate everything and it's not raised by hand. Your servers don't have a name anymore. And if they are sick, you just discard them and replace them with a new automated created or new automatically created instance. This plays into this observability idea as well, where you have like a bigger fleet and you want to observe how are they performing. But I think while pets versus kettle is very well known, I think a more useful approach to look at that is if you look at previously, like the PET, you had this static monolithic architecture, which you have kind of moved to where the kettle is, to the elastic microservice architecture. And what that does in terms of monitoring and observability is previously with that static approach, it was pretty easy because your application was probably in one of two states. You deployed a version and then it was working or it was not working. Now with microservices and everything being made up or out of n different services, it is much more complicated. It's not just n states, but it's probably n factorial states that you can have, because like every one of them, of these n services, could be individually broken and then differently affect all the other services. If you have anything that involves auto-scaling, automatic deployments, or maybe even rollbacks, stuff gets even more complicated because then this n just explodes in different combinations that you could have. And that is where observability is really coming from. In the classic approach where you have this one service, you could just monitor that and you would ping it, for example, to see it's up and everything is working. And that was easy enough. Observability is kind of the tool you need for this newer approach where you have a much more complex landscape, where your integration tests probably will not cover the entire picture anymore. Probably you have discussed before testing in production, different opinions on that. But this is because of the complexity involved in modern architectures that you cannot just recreate that easily anymore anywhere else. So, which leads us to a lot of tools. And as a vendor, you always love tools because there is more stuff to sell, which also kind of makes sense as a user. And putting it into the DevOps perspective again, DevOps came from somewhere else, but it was oftentimes turned into tools or specific jobs or dedicated DevOps departments, which is one of my favorites in DevOps. But who could blame everybody in that area? Because if you look at, for example, system engineers in the US have this salary approximately, I'm not sure if that is really the right value, but this is what I could find. Now, take the same thing, rename it to DevOps, and suddenly you have a much increased salary. So who could blame everybody just to rename their title to DevOps, get the 20% salary increase, and live happily ever after? So we've seen that in DevOps, and the same kind of feels a bit like in observability. Have a monitoring tool, call it observability, probably you can sell it for 20% more afterwards. But that's again not the gist of what it is or what you want to have. So previously you probably were saying, well, we should do DevOps. Nowadays you might say we need to do observability. So what is observability? Since I have said so much about like what it is not and how it can be abused or misused, much like DevOps, the proper, probably the official definition you could have is it's the behavior of the entire system, and it can be determined by only looking at its inputs and outputs, which is the general theory of controlled systems coming from the 60s. But this does not answer the question, what is observability at all? This might be like a definition in a dictionary, but this doesn't solve our problem hands-on here. I think a much more interesting or useful way to look at it is what you know and what you don't know about your system in terms of monitoring. So you have things that you know, so the knowns is like the data that you have, and you know how they will behave. So the things we are aware of and understand. So for example, if you have any system and you know that some part is breaking or this is essential for the serviceability or availability of your service, you might build a dashboard for that. That's a bit like scar tissue. You know things that have failed in the past, you build a dashboard for them, so if they happen again, you will see them again. Then you have stuff like the unknown knowns, things we are not aware of but do understand. So that's like the data that we have collected already. We haven't really built a dashboard for them because they were never really essential in figuring out what was broken or what was not broken. But that would be something that we could add over time to dashboards because we know, well, this is something that will impact our service in the long run. Or it's something that where anomaly detection might come in handy, that you just learn in the past something was behaving in a specific way. And when it changes behavior for whatever reason, you might throw an alert and say like, well, something changed here. Maybe you should look at this, especially if something is broken in your application, this might be a good indicator of what needs fixing in your application. Then you have the known unknowns, things we are aware of, but do not understand. So that's generally the area when you collect a lot more logs and metrics and traces than you currently need. It's just like this over collection that you can then dive into data to actually understand why something is behaving differently than it was before or what is broken here. So that is often the area of this over collection of data. And the final area, and this is really where observability comes into play, is the unknown unknowns. Things we are not aware of and do not understand. And for that is, we try to collect as much raw event data as possible to figure out things we were not before aware that we should look at and things we do not really understand how they are broken, but just to have this wider set of data to dive into that to figure out what is broken. And ideally, without having to redeploy our application to add more lines of logging or to have some more point to collect metrics in our application. The trick here is, as we said in the definition of observability, is was to observe the system just from its inputs and outputs without basically breaking open the box to add something in it to see how it is behaving, but just observing it from the way it is running right now. Maybe you have seen this one, the survivorship bias. It was on Twitter recently and people were discussing if it's really important to know this one or not. I don't think it's really important to know this one. I just like the example. So this was in the Second World War. They were collecting for fighter planes returning from a sortie. They were collecting where did they have the bullet holes in the plane. And then the naive approach would be then, well, wherever the bullet holes are, we should reinforce the plane there because obviously that's where it gets shot. So you want to reinforce that. But then when you go further in the thought process, you will figure out like, well, probably we're more interested in the areas where the planes don't come back. Like, let's assume the bullet holes would have like a normal distribution more or less. Then the ones happening here, here, or here seem to be more critical because the planes that get those do not come back. So probably we should reinforce the plane there. And it's a bit the same with monitoring. If you only focus on things that you know were broken in the past, you will probably not have a complete picture and see how things will develop in the future, or you will not be able to figure out what might break in the future if you just focus on what has happened in the past. This kind of this scar tissue, we build a dashboard, and that's the complete picture we try to have. Because if anything outside of that scope breaks, you will suddenly be blind. It's as if you would reinforce where you have the existing bullet holes for the planes that come back, ignoring the ones that don't come back anymore. So what you're trying to get is, what is the status of my system? And then, like I said, with the monolithic approach in the past, or if you still can probably do that still, it was easy to say because it was working or not working. Whereas with a distributed system, it is much more fine-grained to see what is working and what is not working. And then it is like, what is not working and why is it not working? Okay, so to compare it to something else, monitoring is like you see that your bank state or that your bank account is overdrawn. Observability is knowing why. So it would then tell you, well, you spent all your money on chocolate cakes and sweets. That is more the insight that you're after. So it's not just the metric, how your bank statement is, but the insight really why it is happening. So that's the question you want to answer. Which obviously leads everybody who has like some classic monitoring approach to rebrand as observability. It's pretty much like what people do when they say we have whatever crappy software, we throw it into a container and suddenly we call it cloud native. Same story here, same for DevOps, same for monitoring. So what you want to have is you want to have that instrumentation, and without shipping any new code, you want to understand your system and know the state of your system, even though if it runs into a problem that you have never seen before. So adding additional log lines is not really the solution that you want to get to, or you've had always had that option. It's not going to solve your future problems. Something that might also come into play here, for example, is that you might have want to have the right sampling strategy. So sampling would be you just collect a subset of the traces in your system because it's too much data and too expensive. So the easy approach would be you randomly say, like, I only collect 10% of my traces upfront, and you throw the other 90% away. That's the head-based approach. The tail-based approach is more the more interesting one, where you say at the end, you say, okay, this was a request that ran into an error, or this was a request that was slow. And obviously I want to collect those error states or the slow requests rather than having the fast ones that succeed, because those are not really interesting. So all of those play into like getting the bigger picture and making the most out of your observability story. So now you might say, we just collect all the things and then we're done, right? It's not really that simple, because not all signals are equal in your system. So what you really want to care about is figuring out what do your users care about, or what has an impact on the users. So for example, for a user, a working login will be important, like that they can have a transaction that works. Search works. You can put something into your shopping cart. If the API is available or not, if the user doesn't notice it, if you have some elevated error rate within that, you have like some way to work around, that's not really what users care about. What you want to have is things that the user has an impact on, which leads us to the service levels, which you are probably aware of as well. So you have the indicators, it's like the uptime of my system. And then you have the objective, which is like 99% uptime of my service. And then you have the service level agreement, which might say like, if your service, if your uptime is less than 99%, you owe me some money. And this is what you will probably be focusing on here. But don't go too crazy on the uptime. For example, looking at GitHub's uptime, they seem to be doing pretty well. So probably your system can live with some downtime, some small downtime as well. And final point here, probably don't just look at your failures, but look at how is your system behaving when it's working as well. It's a bit like just trying to figure out how a healthy marriage works by looking at divorces. And the same thing works for your application. If you only look at the error states, you probably don't learn much about the system, how it should behave under normal conditions. And you cannot buy observability. One final example from what I mean when you cannot buy it is, this might be perfectly fine log statement. It's already structured, so we don't have to do any parsing. But what you might want to have here instead is you want to have richer events. So rather than just having the message which tells me something, it's about like saying, okay, this was a login failure for this specific user from this IP. Because with that information, I could answer new questions that I didn't have before. For example, I could figure out like, is one IP address trying to do or break into user accounts? Or is one specific user failing to log in from one specific IP? Are lots of failures followed by one success message? Like having these richer events will allow you to answer questions that you didn't have before. So that's why you want to have like these richer event sets. And there are more things you might want to add here to get a more complete picture. So it's not just about these three pillars, like it's more about the complete picture you want to have. And as always, business values is what you want to have. So to wrap up, monitoring is, you know if the system is working or not, which is good. That's the starting point. Observability is really about why it is not working and what you need to do to get it back into that working state, which is much more interesting, especially if you have not just one service, but N services, which makes this a much more complex problem. And obviously you cannot buy DevOps or observability, though as a vendor, I can totally sell it to you. If you want to know more about that, we have a booth here as well. Also, the only pitch I want to have is we have a Kahoot game, and I don't think anybody yet managed to answer all 10 questions successfully. We had two who got 90% correct. If you want to play that, we also have the link at our booth. We will ship you some swag to the top three players, if I remember correctly. So if you want to test your knowledge, do that. Other than that, slides are available under that QR code, and that's it. I hope I stayed more or less within time, Don.
No, we've got some time left for Q&A, so thank you. Definitely, I honestly loved. I love the analogy that you used for the fighter planes coming back from the wars, where if you're just looking at what succeeded, you don't know what failed. So to take that analogy a little bit further, if we have very little observability in our product because we have to add it ourselves, like you said, it's not something that we can just buy. How can we make sure that we're putting it in the right places and not the wrong places if we don't necessarily know what those wrong places might be?
So, you know, for any complex question, the answer is always, it depends. So there's probably not like this one answer that covers everything. But I would refer to what I tried to say earlier about the, like, where is the business value? Like, what is important for the user? So what is kind of like the flow that you need to cover for a user? And that's kind of like what to focus on. It's not so much about like, oh, there was an error statement in MySQL and there was an error in this specific sub element, because that's not really what the user is focused on. It's really about the user story going through the system. It's like the logins. Like, if the users cannot log in, that's probably a good point to start and like get richer events and then figure out like, why are they not able to log in? If their login failures itself, maybe somebody is doing a denial of service attack. That might not affect the average user, but having those richer events and being able to answer what is going on, that would be kind of like the killer. Where that is in your application, I don't really know, because I guess that depends mostly on like where you're delivering the value for your application.
Right, that makes sense. Are there any maybe red flags that could indicate that we're looking at the wrong things?
Well, I guess the red flags are that you just build up that scar tissue if you're only into that reactive mode. If you're never able to figure out like, oh, this was the problem, and you're always just like, oh, let's add another dashboard because we saw this was a problem in the past. And then you have another outage, and again, you're not really able to figure it out. Either you give up and never figure out what was wrong, or you just say like, oh yeah, right, let's add another dashboard. I think that's a good indicator that maybe you need to switch your approach a bit, like just have these more or less richer events into which you can dive into, rather than just putting like 20 new dashboards there and then you just stare at dashboards. We always jokingly say there are not enough interns in the world to stare at all the graphs in your dashboards to figure out what is wrong in the world. Got it.
Follow-up question from the audience, again from Paul. What and where? How do you feel about lower cardinality auto-instrumentation? That's not something you can have to change your code for, so you can kind of buy it.
You can kind of buy it. Of course, the tools are important. Like, observability is still built on tools. I think just the practice itself, it's not just you buy X, whatever X is, and that equates observability. It's more about understanding your system. And of course, this will then be driven and under or supported by tools. But it's not just I buy tool X, I add it to my application, I'm done. I will just always see what is happening. It's also about writing the application in the right way to kind of like figure out which parts are dependent on what and how do they play together and what is kind of like a successful state and what not. And then just knowing what you need to watch out for. And of course, this will be driven by some metrics and measurements that come out of your application and tools. But it's not just you turn on a tool and it's done.
Right. Could we do too good of a job and maybe instrument too much and get too much observability? And when we do that, does it become a negative?
I don't think it's a negative. It might just get expensive.
Got it.
I mean, there's a good reason why, for example, I forgot the exact number, but I think Netflix already a couple of years ago spent a good amount of their entire infrastructure budget just on monitoring or observability for their application, just because they understood, well, we can build this huge complex application, but we then also need to invest into the tooling to roll it out, but also to monitor it, to actually understand what is going on. So it's not just like you spend 1%. I think it was even a two-digit percentage of their entire infrastructure. The spend was just spent on that observability to see what is happening and react accordingly. And maybe even React before it hits the user.
Right. Well, that's about all the time we have. So thank you for joining us, Philipp. Very much appreciate the talk. And like I said, we're going to have a breakout on observability coming up next. So if you'd like to stay around for that, feel free to join us.